Hello and welcome to Modeling Data Basics with OutSystems. Before we move to what is modeling data, let's first understand what is a data type. All of the information inside an application is called data, and every single piece of information, every single piece of data is of a certain data type that dictates what kind of operations you can carry out with that piece of data. Now, the OutSystems language is what you'd call a strongly typed language. This means that when you create a variable of a certain type, you need to stick to that type for the duration of the life of that variable. It is important to note that the OutSystems language is not object-oriented like C# or Java or C++. This means that there is no type inheritance and certain types of notation that you come to expect from these object-oriented languages do not exist in the OutSystems language. In this slide, you can see some of the basic data types that the OutSystems language supports. You have texts, you have integers, booleans, and date time related variable types. And you can see here some of the default values that variables take once or up to the point that you haven't assigned something to them. So now that we know about data types, what is data modeling? Data modeling is the process of mapping concepts that you have in your application into data types. Now, the majority of concepts are actually complex. They are made up of several items of basic data types. These complex types are what we call the compound types. And the OutSystems platform has three kinds of compound types that you can use. They're called the entities, the static entities, and the structures. An entity is the most common data construct in the OutSystems platform. You normally have an entity for each concept of your application. So a customer, an order, or an ordered item will very likely end up as three distinct entities. An important thing to know is that an entity is always persisted in a database table for you. Every single record that you create, every single customer or order that you create, will end up as a new row in the respective table. You don't have to worry about maintaining the database representations of entities because the platform does this for you. An entity in the OutSystems platform is actually made up of several fields called attributes where your actual data is stored. And it's also supported by system create, read, update, and delete actions that are provided for you. The data of an entity is actually found in the fields that it contains. And each of these fields is called an attribute. Each attribute in the OutSystems platform inside of an entity needs to be one of the basic types that we've seen before. When you create a new entity, there is created for you already an ID attribute that allows for relational operations. We will cover these later on. Now, every attribute that you create inside an entity ends up being a column in the database table for that entity. Much like the entity itself, you don't have to worry about maintaining the database representation of the attributes of these columns, because the OutSystems platform will take care of that for you. Much like everything in the OutSystems platform, the process of creating an entity is very, very simple. In Service Studio, you want to go into the data layer, right-click the entities folder, and select Add an Entity. The important property that you need to set up is the name of the entity. This will dictate, obviously, how you interact and how you refer to it, and also will dictate the physical table name of this entity in the database. Once you have your entity, attribute creation is a breeze. You just right-click the desired entity and select Add Entity Attribute, and you need to make sure that you set up at least the name of the attribute and the data type for obvious reasons. There's also a property that very commonly you will want to set up, which is the isMandatory. You want to flick this to yes if you want to enforce that, for example, when this attribute is asked of the user in an input, that he needs to fill in this in the form. The OutSystems platform tries to help you in the process of creating your attributes, and it does so by looking at the name that you give to an attribute that you've created. And depending on what the name is, it tries to infer what the type of that attribute is. Over here you can see some of the matches, some of the substrings that it will look for, and what data type it will assign by default to the attribute. Of course, you can afterwards go over there and change it in case the match isn't the correct one. As mentioned, every entity that you create in your application has a set of system actions, system procedures that you can apply, that you can execute on top of that entity. These operations, these CRUD operations, are what we call entity actions, and you'll be able to use them to create, update, delete, and retrieve entities from the database. This slide just summarizes some of the entity actions. In fact, it has all of the entity actions that exist, together with a small explanation of what each one of them does. There is a special kind of entity called static entity. It is very similar to an entity as we described. It has its own database table, but unlike a normal entity, you cannot dynamically create new records for a static entity. They're actually created at design time within Service Studio. So every single record that you create over there is known intrinsically by the OutSystems language. This allows you to gain access to certain accelerators while referring to the known records of an entity. So in a sense, you can also use them not just as if they were a database table, but also as if they were an enumerate. And obviously it goes without saying that you do not have creation and deletion and alter operations over static entities. You just have the retrieve ones, because again, they cannot be created, updated, or deleted dynamically in runtime. The process of defining a static entity is very, very similar to an entity. You just create a static entity by adding it, and then you create the attributes within. You're also subject to the limitations of having the basic data types for these attributes. Static entities are used for concepts in your application whose values don't change during the life of an application. A good example is the list of countries in the world. So you could create a country static entity, define whatever number of attributes you want that will define each and every country, and then by right-clicking the records folder, add as many records, as many countries in this case, as you want. Then upon selecting each record, you can define what are the values for the attributes in that particular record. In this example over here, we can see what is the country code for Portugal. Here you can see the example of usage of this fast way to reference a specific static entity record. You can see on point one that Portugal is being referenced directly by name, and we are fetching the country information, the full country record for Portugal, and then accessing its country code. Don't worry too much right now if some of this, or if this dialogue doesn't mean too much. It will become clear once you start to use it. The main point, the key takeaway point, is that you can use static entity as you would use a normal entity, but you can also use it in almost an enumerate kind of way. The third and final kind of compound data type that we have in OutSystems is called the structure. It is somewhat similar to an entity, but unlike an entity, there isn't a table for each structure that you create. So effectively, you normally create structures to hold temporary data formats that you then want to process. And once you do process them, you want to throw away that result. For example, the returns of integration systems. Since structures exist solely in memory, they don't have the limitations of a database column. So this means that its attributes don't necessarily need to be confined to basic data types like entities and static entities. So it is possible to have structures inside structures, or even entities inside structures. Again, the process of creating a structure is very, very similar to an entity and a static entity. It's just right-clicking on the appropriate folder and then adding the attributes. Now, over here in this particular example, we're highlighting the fact that this structure, the combined customer info, actually has three attributes of very diverse types. We have a customer entity, we have a country static entity, and we just have a normal basic data type attribute, in this case, a date. Before we continue, let's just make a small detour and talk a little bit about variables. If you use variables in other languages, you know already what we're talking about. They are storage locations referenced by a name that store data of a certain type. Can be either a basic type or one of the compound types that we've discussed. Now, every single variable, depending on its nature, has a certain scope. This is the area of the application where that variable is visible and you can access its value. Now, depending on how the value of a variable is born on its scope, you can classify it as either an input variable, an output variable, or a local variable. Over here, we have an action that does something, a piece of code that does something. We're creating an input parameter that is of integer type. This means that when you call this action, you can pass into the action a number to be used by the code. Over here, you can see the process of adding an output parameter. This means that this variable will be visible, its value will be visible from the context where this action is called. So you will want to affect the value before the code inside this action completes and then access it from the caller. Finally, you can have a pure local variable. This means that this variable is not at all visible from the context that calls this action. It's just born over there. And here we have a sample of a customer that is local to this sum action. So far, we focused on variables that have a single item of their data type. But you can actually have a sequence of variables, of values of that data type, and we call those lists. You can dynamically add and remove from a list. And this list, the atom of a list, can be from a basic type, such as an integer, to a compound type, such as a list of customers, or you can even combine things and have, as is an example here, a list of a combination of country, dates, and texts. The most common places where you see lists are obviously the outputs of queries to the database, but there's nothing keeping you from creating ad hoc in-memory lists of a certain atom type. And obviously the use of the lists comes when you iterate over them and you apply a certain operation over them, be it a renderization or a processing step. Here you can see an example of a list. That blue square node that you see over there is a query. It's what we call an aggregate. And let's just assume that it fetches in some way that you will learn later all of the customers in the database whose first name is Michael. On the screenshot to the right, you can see how we can access the last name of a row of this aggregate output. Reading from the right to the left, we're accessing the last name of a customer that is in the current row of the list that is the output of get customers named Michael. Very, very easy. And this is it for modeling data basics in the OutSystems platform. In a later lesson, we will expand on this information and tell you how you can create relationships between entities. Stay tuned for that.